still in God's presence. I don't know about you all, but I am. So you're going to have to bear with me because I've got a little bit of peace going on, a little bit of joy going on, and I got a little bit of excitement. So I'm hoping my mind will catch up with how my heart is feeling in the spirit. God has been speaking to me, and I mentioned it last week in part one, the last few months, how God has been speaking to me about how he wants us as a body of Christ to begin to move and understand and operate more in the ministry of healing, and how much there's such a need in mankind for healing, and how through his son he has provided that through the church. And not all of the church has been taught or has realized that they have been given that gift and that ministry of healing, and that we should be blessing others with it. And you know, we all know that the Word of God in Hebrews says that faith comes by hearing and hearing by the Word of God. And so if you don't hear that Word of God and you're not instructed that healing is part of what Christ has delivered to you through the covenant, you don't realize the authority and responsibility that you have as a Christian, as a disciple of Christ, to offer prayer and to offer the ministry of healing to people who are in your circle. Amen. To people who God brings across your path that need healing. And so we're going to continue in part two today about that ministry and responsibility. You know, sometimes we forget that, you know, freely it's been given to us, but we also have a responsibility to freely give it. And it's, you know, it's a wonderful gift that we have received, but we also have a responsibility to share that gift with others. And so God is reminding us, and that's something I think that God is trying to show us and wants us to grow in that maturity of understanding that it's, you know, sometimes we're babies in Christ, and then sometimes we grow and we're in grade school. But, you know, sometimes you have to go on to junior high, and then you have to go on to high school, and then you have to go on to college. And then at some point, God wants you to get a job and go work. Get out of the house and go work. So, let's talk about that today. And let's look at, you all will go to me in Matthew 10. And we talked about that last week. If you get an opportunity, please go to YouTube or go to our Trinity Worship Center site and look at part one so that you can go back and see what we discussed. And how we discussed about several things about how we're to pray, and we're to pray to the Father, and we're to pray in Jesus' name. We're taught that, Jesus taught that in John 14. And we're told that all things are possible with God. They're not possible with man, but they're possible with God. We hear that in Luke. And then Jesus, all of these are things Jesus taught us. And Jesus taught us that there were five signs that disciples should operate in to show that we're his, that we're his disciples. And he taught us that in Mark 16. And then he talks about how we're to baptize in the name of the Father and the name of the Son and the name of the Holy Spirit. So we're not to be afraid, folks. Remember, we're not to be afraid of using the name of Jesus when we pray. And we're not to be afraid of the Holy Spirit helping us when we pray. Jesus was not afraid of his disciples calling on the Holy Spirit to help. In fact, he said, the Father's going to send the Holy Spirit to help you after I leave. He's not going to leave you as orphans. And so Jesus himself said to baptize in the name of the Father and the Son and the Spirit. So we're not to be afraid of the Holy Spirit. In other words, folks, we're not supposed to be doing this on our own. We've been given the Word and we've been given the Spirit. So God, Jesus isn't saying go out there and do all this on your own. He's saying I'm giving you the tools you need. I'm giving you the help. I'm giving you my word. I'm giving you the name. You're just praying my name to the Father, and the Father will help you. And he said, and by the way, you've got the Holy Spirit to help you too. Okay, so let's go to
Matthew 10. Now, everybody got a Bible? Because you know we're serious about reading the Bible in this church. Okay, Matthew 10. And it starts out with, this is Jesus. And he is talking and he's ministering and he's teaching deep things to his disciples. And he says to them, Matthew 10, 1, and when he had called his 12 disciples to him, he gave them power over unclean spirits to cast them out and to heal all kinds of sickness and all kinds of disease. Now, I want you to note, you might even circle, underline, and pencil in your Bible, however you feel comfortable doing it. It doesn't say only certain kinds, just a few kinds. It says all kinds of sickness, all kinds of disease. How many of y'all know that Jesus is not limited? All things are possible to him. So he says he gives them power to do all kinds of to heal and cast out and all to heal all kinds of sickness and all kinds of disease. Do you all know Jesus was not afraid of cancer? He was not afraid to pray and heal someone who had leprosy, or someone who had cancer, or someone had something that the doctors say it's incurable. Jesus had no fear of praying for that person and then receiving healing. We've got to stop thinking, oh, they've got that sickness, I'm not even going to pray for that. We've got to stop limiting God. Okay? If you know that God is telling you to pray for that, you need to pray for that and believe Jesus is unlimited. All right. Now, he goes on in 2 and 3 and 4. And I just want to point out, you know, he names who the 12 are. But I want to point out something to you. And as I was reading this, I felt like the Holy Spirit was bringing this out. You know, we know most of these he called as fishermen. They were laborers. They weren't theologians. They weren't well-educated. They were just laborers. In other words, they didn't have long or wrong teaching. They hadn't been taught a whole lot of churchy religious stuff. Just simple common sense people. Like us, most of us. And then it says, he just happens to throw in Matthew, the tax collector. Okay, so he's got Matthew, who has this, you know, they really hate tax collectors. So Matthew is doing this job that the other guys were like, that's a nasty job. We all hate that kind of job. But basically, they thought of them as thieves. So he throws Matthew in there as one of the apostles, one of the disciples. But I want you to look at the awesome 4. He throws in Simon. It says Canaanite. That also means zealot. Now, that means he's like a political zealot. He was really politically active, and he had this mentality of social and cultural change was going to happen through government and political modification or radical change. So we've got this other guy over here who's really thinks government is going to fix it. And he throws these two, and then he throws Judas in there. So he's got these 3 out of the 12 that are just oddballs. He throws them in the mix. Why would God do that? Why would Jesus do that?
Make me feel better.
Yeah. You know what I think? I think he's saying, look, it doesn't matter what you do for a living. It doesn't matter your political view. It doesn't matter what your family background. You know, Judas's family background is not good. It doesn't matter any of that stuff. Nothing like that limits you from being my disciple if you choose to follow me. And none of that stuff will limit you from, if your heart really wants to be my disciple, me giving you the power to go do the works I'm calling my disciples to do. None of that limits you from following me, and none of that limits me from giving you the power to do the job. Education, don't let anything limit you in your mind from thinking, I can do just as much for God as they can do. Jesus picked these oddballs and threw them all in a mix, and they followed him around for 3.5 years. He did wonders and works without limitation, just because they believed him. And we can do the same thing. And that's why he chose them and listed them. So that here, 2,000 plus years, we can realize, hey, there's no limits on me either then. It's all up to me. All right. Now, I want us to focus starting on 5. This is, then these 12 Jesus sent out and commanded them. Now, we need to be aware, anytime the Bible says Jesus commanded them, we need to pick up and be aware. Remember last time we talked about how we need to be aware of time. You know, is the Word of God talking about the past, the current, or the present? Because a lot of times in a passage, he will refer to the past, the present, and future, and prophesy the future. That's why Jesus was hard for them to understand. Because he will talk about what's going on, he will talk about what's going to happen, and he will prophesy what's going to happen to him. And they'll be like, I don't even know what this man is saying. So be aware, he's saying, he's commanding them, and he sent out, he sent them out saying, do not go into the way of the Gentiles, and do not enter into the city of the Samaritans, but rather go to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Now we might think, modern day thinking, why was Jesus being prejudiced? Why was he saying, don't go there, just go there? Think. He's sending them out without him, right? And he's saying, I want you to go out and I want you to do the stuff you can see me do. But I want you to go to the Jews. And I want you to go over here to the Samaritans and to the Gentiles. Was Jesus really prejudiced? Did he only come for the Jews? Well, no, we know that, right? In retrospect, we know that. But Jesus understood their belief systems, right? The Samaritans believed in multiple gods. The Gentiles believed in no gods, some gods, the emperor is a god, demigods. They believed in all kinds of crazy stuff, right? Kind of what we still have now, all kinds of different religions. And the Samaritans were half. They picked some of the Jewish beliefs, some of the Hebrew stuff, some of the other stuff. They didn't marry, so they had a little bit of everything going on. Do you remember the Samaritan woman who came to Jesus? And she said about her little daughter, you know, and please heal my daughter and that. And he said, well, you know, I've just come. And she said, yeah, but even the little dog eats crumbs off the table. You remember? And we think, well, why was he so firm with her and didn't want to do that? And then when she says that, he says, your faith. See, he's wondering, he's questioning her about, as a Samaritan woman, as a Samaritan, are you on the Jewish side as a Samaritan in your belief of one God, the God? Or are you over here just, well, you're going to come to one of the gods that can heal your daughter? And when she finally said that to him, he realized, he said, your faith. Well, it was your faith in the one God, you see. And he pulled that out of her. So basically he's saying, don't go into these other places where you're going to not only be combating demons and disease and all these other things, but you're also going to be combating all of these ideologies of multiple gods and all of this other stuff. I want you just to stay focused on at least people who believe in the Hebrew God, the God, the God Father who I'm representing. Now, why is that important to us?
couldn't go off campus yet.
They couldn't go off campus yet.
But even Jesus said in certain places that he was not able to do any miracles because of their lack of faith.
Do you know? This was their first trial run. Okay. This is the first time I'm sending you out. When we first send our kids out to do something, it's going to be hard. It's going to be risky. Let's say we send them to start learning how to drive a car. Do we just give them a car keys and tell them, yeah, get the car, boy, and go out there and learn to drive?
Yes.
Most of the time we don't, right? They become a student driver. So Jesus is not throwing them out there to the whole world to learn how to minister, is he? He's sending them out there into the Jewish people who at least recognize there's only one God, Jehovah. Make sense? He's not sending them out into the world where they have to combat all these other ideas of multiple gods, all these other ideologies where they won't even have that similarity of we're doing this in the name of. Now, why is it important? That should give us confidence that when God is sending us and directing us to go out, he's not, now we can do it ourselves, but he's not sending us out into crazy places, unprepared, unshielded, unprotected. He's always going to be a good shepherd, even as he's training us to go learn how to pray for people for healing. Do you know that's the function of the church? The church is about training you and teaching you how to learn to minister to people outside of the church, just like they're doing. So he's not being prejudiced here by saying, don't go over there. He's just saying, go here where at least they understand there's only one God. Okay? 7. As you go. Now, I want to point out to you, in 7, he says, as you go preach, saying, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. When we begin to think, and you know what, as people start to watch your life and see the fruit in your life as a Christian, you don't have to ask them. They're going to come to you and say, hey, my mom is sick, my husband is sick, my kid is sick, somebody's in the hospital. They're going to just naturally come to you because they know you're a Christian. And they're going to say, will you please pray for? I want you to see that in 5, Jesus told them. See, this is, a lot of times this is where we miss it. Jesus actually told them, don't go here, but go here. And see, sometimes we miss it because we just think, splatter, like a shotgun. I'll just splatter and go everywhere, somewhere in a land and somebody will get you. Now, we should pray. It is our responsibility to pray for people. Okay? But I'm talking about going, where Jesus is saying, go. And see, sometimes we question, I don't know, you know, I went over there and I prayed for them and they didn't get healed. Well, I'm wondering, did you pray before you went and ask, am I supposed to go? See, that's where maturity comes in us learning to be ministers. Just because they call you on the phone or just because they ask you
You still have to check with the boss. Did y'all realize he's the boss? You still need to check with the boss. Hey, am I supposed to go? Even if it's somebody in the office next to you, you should ask God, am I supposed to go and pray for them, or am I supposed to just stay here and pray for them? It could be a huge difference. Okay, so I know some of us have heard this, just go pray for them, go lay hands on them and pray for them. But I'm telling you that Jesus said, don't go some places and go other places.
That's right.
And that's where we need to be more discerning. It's not a shotgun ministry.
Precise.
Yeah. We should be a rifleman. We should be a sharpshooter. We just go right where he is. And that's where we go minister what he says. All right. So 5. As you're going. Now, as you're going is an active thing. As you're going, preach, saying the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Every time we're going and we're praying or whatever we're doing as Christians, as a representative of Christ, we should be preaching. Now, that doesn't mean standing up here preaching and giving them the Bible, you know, and being a hard sell about it. But do you know our life is supposed to be preaching? Our love is supposed to be preaching? Our compassion is supposed to be preaching? We could just be dropping off food and saying, you know, God laid this on my heart. I brought this over to you. We don't have to necessarily be preaching to them or telling them their sin is wrong. But those type of things can be preaching and proclaiming the love of God to them. Those are simple things we can do in any environment, even in the workplace. That's how we can be proclaiming the love of God. Okay. So he's saying, as you go, preach, saying. Say. So you do have to say something, whether it's a card, you know, in your card. You know, you can say something in there. You know, praying for you. You don't have to get all preachy on them, especially if you know that they're out of church and they're not, their walk isn't right. You know, love to have you join me in church. It could be something so simple. Call me if you ever need a ride to church. Something like that. We don't want to bring the condemnation on them, okay? But we're preaching the love of God to them. Okay. 8. Then he says, as you're going preaching, saying. So this is not a separate thing. It's not a Pastor Sam and I are preaching, and then someone else is healing the sick. It's that we're doing these all simultaneously at the same time. Okay? So as we're going and we're preaching, saying, at the same time as we're preaching, then we're healing the sick. And while we're going and preaching, we are cleansing the lepers. And while we're going and preaching, we are raising the dead. While we're going and preaching, we are casting out demons. And while we are going and preaching, we are freely giving what we have received. See, we're missing that. We're thinking, oftentimes, I think, we are thinking that these are isolated events. I just do one, and then I do the other, and then I do the other. And the truth is, sometimes I may not realize, is that person really needing a healing or a cleansing? I may not really know the root of that disease or that affliction. You know, we may not know that leprosy really needs cleansing. We might think leprosy needs healing. But in the Bible and in what Jesus' words were, he actually clarified them as being completely separate things, separate needs. And yet, Jesus says, and this
I want us to get in our mindset that all of these things should be happening while we're doing this preaching, while we're telling them God loves you, while we're telling them this is because Christ loves you just like he loves me. And this, now I want to bring down about this freely you've given. Freely you receive, freely you've given. When we have people who come in, or people anywhere, could be at work, could be on the street, whatever, and we pray for them and they receive healing, this free means free, without any debt, without any strings attached. And so what that means, and you know our human nature is so ingrained in us, we don't even realize the stuff we do sometimes. That means without any obligation. So we're giving them, maybe they do receive a wonderful healing, or they do receive, and you can tell, you can tell that they've been freed of that, whatever that sin, maybe it's an addiction, whatever it is. You know what? That was a free gift from God. That does not mean they have to come to church with you. That does not mean that they have to pray the sinner's prayer and get saved with you. That does not mean they have to make up with their wife and get their life straightened out. It doesn't mean any obligation. And see, I've seen this happen. We think, oh, we prayed for them and they received a wonderful healing, they should become church members now. That's not what this is. This is a with no strings attached. Remember the 10 lepers that Jesus healed? And the one came back to Jesus and said, where are the other nine? He never saw them again. I think that's why he brought that to point. They just went, they were happy, they went back to their families, went on their way. And one came back and thanked him and worshiped him. Folks, that's the way it's going to be. We're going to minister to people. Some will be Christians, some won't. Some will be dedicated disciples that will really turn their lives around because God did a wonderful thing for them. And some won't. Some will just go right about their business and go back into their lives, and it seems like a month later they forgot what God did for them. And we have to not let that be negative to us.
Right.
We have to just accept that the way Jesus accepted that and realize that's humanity. And, you know, I prayed for him and God did an, you know, we've all seen that. God do an amazing healing for somebody. Free of alcoholism or drug addiction or whatever. And a month later, they're not in church. They're gone. It's like they've just forgotten what God did for them. And we have to accept that, you know what? That was we received from you again. And not allow that to harden our hearts. And just keep giving it out. Just keep giving it out anyway. Just keep loving people anyway. Because there will be the one. There will be the one out of 10 that says, wow, I recognize what God did for me. I want to be a disciple. So, I think God is preparing us for this healing ministry. Now, I want to go on. Be worthy. You're going to go. They're going to invite you to dinner or whatever, out for lunch. And you're going to talk to them, and you're going to tell them, and you're going to share from your heart how good God is and all these things. And, you know, later they're going to go in there, you know, they're going to laugh. They're not going to take it serious. They're not going to understand, or it's not going to be important to them. They're not going to see the value in being a Christian, a real Christian. But I want you to recognize something. Go on down to 16 through 20. And Jesus cautions them. He cautions them as they begin to operate in this type of ministry. And he says, "Behold, I send you out as sheep amidst wolves. Therefore be wise as serpents and as harmless as doves." Now, the responsibility for that is on you, the disciple. It's not how the other person treats you. It's not any of that stuff. It's how you guard your heart and your mind. You be wise as a serpent. Be cunning. Realize everything is not as it seems. They talk all sweet and kind to you and everything, and then they go talk bad about you behind your back and say, "I can't believe she believed all that with God, that God will just do the impossible, and God's just so good, and God answers prayer. She's just crazy. She just believes all that stuff that the Bible says." But they act like they're your best friend in front of you. But he says, be as harmless as doves. In other words, keep your mouth shut. Don't be out there firing ammo right back at you. Be harmless as doves. But I want to remind you. And he says that some are going to be out and out vicious. They're going to be mean. They'll deliver you up. They'll make fun of you openly. But he says in 20, something that should give you reassurance. And basically he says, it's not for you to worry about. He says in 20. Well, actually, I'll start with 19. "But when they deliver you up, do not worry." In other words, when they catch you in the break room, they make fun of you in front of other people. "But when they deliver you up, do not worry about how or what you should speak. For it will be given to you in that hour what you should speak. For it is not you who speaks, but it's the Spirit of your Father who speaks in you." I want you to see something. Because, you know, a lot of times people won't pray for other people. They won't pray with another person. They won't offer to pray with another person aloud because they're afraid of what people are going to think or say. That's the honest truth. We don't want to come back on us. We're scaredy cats. They're not going to crucify you like they did them. But we're still afraid. We're afraid of a little backlash. So we don't offer what we've been freely given because, you know, it might be uncomfortable for us at work or whatever. But he says, don't worry about it. Don't even premeditate how am I going to answer what I'm going to say. Because he says it's the Spirit of his Father, your Father, that will give you what to say at that time. And I want you to notice something in verse 20. He says it's the Spirit of your Father who speaks in you. It's in you. The Holy Spirit of Father is in you already. That should give you great comfort. That if you will let your blah, blah, blah mind and mouth get out of the way, the Holy Spirit will speak the perfect words to answer when they come against you for doing what God has told you to do. And you're no different than Abraham and Isaac and Jacob. You know, they were surrounded by a world too that didn't believe, ha, 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 there's one God, how silly are you? You know, we worry too much. We worry and we're so afraid that we don't do anything when we should do something. And the enemy closes our mouth just because we're afraid before we ever even get started. Now, I want you to look at 37. Because I'm not telling you it's all going to be great. Jesus isn't telling you it's all going to be great either. And a man's enemies will be those of his own household. And he who loves father or mother more than me is not worthy. And he who loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. And he who does not take up his cross to follow me is not worthy of me. He who finds his life loses it, and he who loses his life for my sake can find it. Now, for those of you who have a paper Bible, it is in red. These are what Jesus has been telling them and preparing them for before they go out on this road of ministry. And he's telling them, you are going to have your own family members that are not going to like you being a open, stand-up Christian. They are going to tell you, be quiet, sit down, and just let the preacher pastors do the work. And they are not going to like you making a decision to be a real Christian disciple that goes and does what the Bible and what Jesus instructs you to do. They would rather you say, hey, tell them to call your pastor and let your pastor pray for them. That would get you off the hook, wouldn't it? Well, there's not enough pastors in the world to take care of everybody's prayer needs. Are you willing to risk it to be my servant? I want you to leave with this thought. And this is going to blow your mind. This is where we're going to follow it. Three. This word heal that Jesus said, heal. I want to tell you what the word Jesus used, what it really means. When Jesus said, heal the sick, this word has two meanings. This word that he said, heal the sick, means to wait upon or to serve them manually. Meaningly. So, when he said, go heal the sick, he says, go serve them. And wait upon them meanly. In other words, get down, humble yourself, and serve them. They're sick. He's not saying leave them in that situation, but he's saying go serve them, and it's not going to be hotty-totty work. That's the first meaning of the word he used for heal. You're not going to believe what the second word, second meaning means. This is the exact same word with dual meaning. The second part of that word.
word means adore God. Worship. I checked that like 8 times. I said, that can't be right. That is what the word means. Heal means, also means to adore God and worship. Now, I got to thinking and praying about that. I'm like, I know Jesus did not make any mistakes with words he used. He was perfect in his word choice because he knew we would be using them forever. But how can you mean that two ways? How could that work with two references? And I realized, when we are serving others by healing, ministering the healing through Christ Jesus to them, as his servants, as his ministers, at that very moment, we are worshiping and adoring God. Think about that. God sees that act, our act of ministering healing, as worshiping and adoring him. Is that not amazing? That to God, that's an act of worship. Yeah, we're going to have to just soak on that all week long. Because I'm just like, is that not so God? That he takes something we do, menial service. So our menial service to mankind, he considers worship. Now think about it. Why do you think that was Christ? Jesus went about everywhere healing the sick and casting out demons. Because it was an act of service and worship to Father. As he ministered to mankind, it was an act of worship, service to Father. And that's exactly the example that he wants us to model to the world. Is that not one of those blow your mind thoughts? Jesus used that word intentionally to give us greater understanding of what his intention for his church is to do in the world. No wonder he said, they will know you by your love. He didn't say they would know us by our strength, by our power. They would know us by our love. It's our actions of service and ministry to the world. And that's what, when we worship God, that's when the power of the Holy Spirit becomes present. And it's the power of the Holy Spirit and prayer, faith in God and in his goodness, that draws God to move in that person's situation. Okay, that's good, folks. That's rich. You're going to think about that all week until next week. That got me. When the Holy Spirit showed me that, that got me, so I'm hoping y'all will be thinking, wow, isn't that what the cross is about? The cross is two-way. The cross is Christ to man, and man back up to Father. And that's what the ministry of healing is. It's us ministering to man, and us worshiping God. It's the two-way relationship, it's the same thing. All right, y'all stand with me. We're going to close. Holy Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for us being just allowed to come in freedom and worship.
Easter is drawing near to us and that we understand its meaning. We pray for more people to be able to understand and receive the gift that was provided for us through the cross. We pray and just ask that those that will be listening to this message will understand the importance of the church's ministry for healing, and that those that have a need for healing will realize that it is your greatest desire, Father, to heal your people. We ask these things in the precious name of Jesus. Thank you for joining us at Trinity Worship Center in Kingston, Tennessee. We'd love to have you visit us.